David McGee and Cross the Bridge want to bless you and help you. We have a series that will improve your relationship with God, improve your relationship with family and loved ones, and help you understand the Bible more. We are offering the greatest gift. This is sure to help you as well as bless you and those around you. So don't wait. Call now. Operators are standing by now, waiting on your call to get you this series that will help you know the love you are looking for. If you order in the next hour, we will include a free surprise gift, our way of saying thanks. So call now or go online and order now, and don't wait. Haven't you waited long enough to know more love?
We've put together, especially for you, a teaching package through 1 Corinthians 13. Now, we've spent hours of teaching and encouraging information in there. So let me encourage you to get this package to help you to both love other people more and to be loved more. And you'll be encouraged as you do. Thanks so much.
Welcome to Cross the Bridge with David McGee. Let's join Pastor David now as he continues his verse-by-verse teaching of God's Word.
When I encourage you, I'm filling you with courage. When you encourage me, you're filling me with courage. Why is that so important? Because a lot of the rest of the world is trying to discourage you in your spiritual faith. They're trying to tear you down from following Jesus. You know what I'm talking about. Some of your family, some of your friends, some of your coworkers. And it, maybe that's not this diabolical thing of wanting to strip your faith from you. It's just what happens because they don't believe like you do. So you got all these people gathered around you trying to tear you down and bum you out. And then you got the body of Christ, which is a place where we should be built up. Another couple words that you'll see in this chapter a lot is edify or exhort. And you'll hear me just define that simply as to build up. To build up. And we're talking, and again, talking about prophesying. And again, we think of prophesying as predicting future events, but it's really one that delivers and teaches God's word under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Amen? That's another definition there. One that delivers and teaches God's word under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And when somebody is speaking on behalf of God, you always want to look at what they're saying, compare it back to Scripture. That's important. To discern. The Bible talks about discerning whether somebody, if somebody's speaking on behalf of God, what they're saying is valid. And that's, you know, I'm always encouraging you guys to dig in the Scripture, make sure what I'm saying is solid. And of course, one of the blessings of going verse by verse is, you know, it's impossible to drift very far. Verse 5 here in the New Living Translation reads this: I wish you could all speak in tongues. Again, that's very vague, Paul. I wish you would say what you meant here. But even more, I wish you could all prophesy. I wish you could all speak on behalf of God, if you will. For prophecy is greater than speaking in tongues unless someone interprets what you are saying so that the whole church will be strengthened. Again, this is speaking more about prophecy, saying it's more important. And I'm not saying that I'm the only one here that can prophesy. We're all supposed to speak to others on behalf of God. Anytime that you share the good news, guess what you're doing? You're speaking to somebody else on behalf of God. Now, does it mean that you begin to quiver or shake or have some kind of strange experience? It means we are all supposed to be speaking to other people on behalf of God. And that's prophecy. And again, when it speaks in tongues, I know some people can get really uncomfortable with the subject. Don't. When you begin to get anxious about something, that's not God usually. I mean, God may, you know, if you're going into a dangerous situation, may, you know, trigger that warning light, but the Bible talks about this in many places. In 1 Corinthians 13, verse 8, it went through it. And it's talking about how more important love is, more important than tongues and prophecy. Love never fails. But whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. Now again, as we went through that chapter, we talked about the fact that doesn't mean that prophecies or tongues or knowledge is not for the church today. It just means love is more important. And then when we're in heaven, these other things that are kind of in part will be done away with. And again, let's understand that the Bible does speak about this issue. Mark 6, chapter 16, verse 17 says, "And these signs will follow those that believe in my name. They will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. And if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover." So it says, you know, if somebody's a new believer, they're cast out demons, speak with new tongues, pick up serpents, and drink poison. Does that mean we're all supposed to pick up snakes? No. No, no, no. We do that on Thursday night. No, I'm kidding. We don't. But 1 Corinthians 12, it spoke about that, verse 39. It says, "Are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles, do all have gifts of healings, do all speak with tongues, do all interpret?" Well, the obvious answer is no. Not everybody is a prophet. Not everybody's an apostle or a teacher or does miracles or healings or tongues. Now, there are some churches that say, well, no, everybody has to speak in tongues. And if you're filled with the Spirit, you have to speak in tongues. I don't believe that. I don't believe the Bible teaches that. Other people even take it more extreme and they say, well, you don't go to heaven unless you're speaking in tongues. I don't believe that either. But verse 12, jumping down in 1 Corinthians 14, chapter 14, verse 12, it does say this, "And the same is true for you, since you're so eager to have the special abilities the Spirit gives, seek those that will strengthen the whole church." Well, I'm going to spend more time on that when we get to that. But the obvious thing is you don't want the gifts just for, you know, to say, oh, I got this gift and that gift. I've talked to people that it's you know, I've done this and I've got this gift and I got that gift and da 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 da. It's like, well, it's not for you. It's for the church. It's not for the blowing. It's for the growing. Okay, it's not for you to blow on about how you got all the gifts. It's for the body to grow. These supernatural gifts, sir. That's what they're for. And you know, here's an interesting thing. Occasionally I'll run into somebody that talks about, you know, the church. Well, I don't feel like I need to go to the church. You know, I feel like I can spiritually grow better without the church. You've heard this. Maybe you've been one of those people. I can worship God better sitting in the middle of a field. You know? Home. Here's the problem with that. The Bible's indicating that we're supposed to build up the body. We're supposed to build up the church. How do you do that if you're not in it? How do you build up the church if you're not part of it? You can't. So guess what you're supposed to do? You're supposed to be part of it. You're supposed to be part of it. And the awesome thing is, that's not just a self-sacrificing, you know, I encourage people, but you know what? You guys so often and so much encourage me. The last few weeks especially, I've been getting a lot of emails, calls, cards of people encouraging me and saying, hey, you know, because as a pastor's heart, you know, when somebody says something ugly or hurts my feelings or somebody that I've loved on or poured out says something, does something, that hurts, but man, to have so many people say, hey, Pastor, we're with you. We love you, and we're going places, man. That's encouraging. Amen? So, and that's what's supposed to happen in the body. I encourage you. You encourage me. We encourage each other. Because God is going to use us to grow each other. You understand that? And that is part of that's part of being in a fellowship, in a community of faith. It's because in that community, some people you'll really get along with, and some people will really irritate you. There's going to be folks in this body that, you know, you're walking down the hall, I saw that. But here's what's interesting. That person that's irritating you is doing more for your spiritual growth than perhaps anybody else in here. Yeah, that was kind of weak. Some of you didn't like that, did you? Look, they're helping you die to that selfish nature by just irritating it out of you. I mean, that's but that's part of why we need each other. It's the next life lesson. We each need to grow up in our faith. We each need to grow up in our faith. None of us has arrived. I haven't arrived. I'm still growing. But I tell you what, you know, especially in ministry, God digs down deep and says, oh, look at this. You need to get rid of this. And it's a journey of God pointing out these things. And we become individually spiritual stronger, and we also become corporately or as a fellowship spiritually stronger. I think back on some people that showed up that didn't know Jesus as their Savior, and they got saved, and they sat under the teachings, and they were here every time the doors are open. Now to turn around and watch those people teach others and disciple others. Man, that is so encouraging. Because God wants, He wants to use all of us. He wants to use all of us. And let's understand, while Paul is speaking here about building up the church, there's going to be people who want to tear it down. That's life. There's going to be folks that want to tear down what we're doing, what I'm doing, what you're doing. Why? Because God's doing something. I mean, do you really think that, you know, if there's a church down the road, no offense to anybody, but if there's a church down the road that, you know, has 50 people that they baptized somebody 7 years ago was their last baptism, you know, the enemy's not going to spend a lot of time on that fellowship. But if, let's just say, there's another church where, you know, over 200 people a year are getting baptized and people all over the world are getting saved through that ministry, don't you think the enemy is going to point his attack towards that fellowship? And what's that going to look like? Well, if he can get inside and get people within that fellowship trying to tear it down, that's going to be the most successful attack, isn't it? So recognize that. When somebody you know or care about starts to tear it down, you say, whoa, 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 whoa. We're supposed to be building this place up. And recognize an attack for what it is. You know, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 17 says, honor all people. That's kind of interesting. It says all people. Love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. It's a great verse. Let me point out something. Some of you are not going to like this. Honor all people. Love the brotherhood. Honor all people means people of other faiths. Honor them. Don't demean them. Have conversations and yes, in love, say, you know what? I don't believe that's right. I think you guys are wrong on this, man. But treat them with honor. But then, look what it says, love the brotherhood. Love the people that you're spiritually related to. Amen? We talked about that last week, and you know, the first verse talked about, you know, pursue love. And we talked about the great quest to love. We looked at John 3:16, for God so loved the world. And now that's our quest. To love the world, to love the people in it. Verse 6 says, but now, brethren, if I come to you speaking with tongues, what shall I profit you unless I speak to you either by revelation, by knowledge, by prophesying, or by teaching? See, and again, it's interesting because in this chapter, Paul is saying, look, you guys have put too much emphasis on this unknown language thing. And perhaps they thought it was such a cool gift or whatever. And let's understand, too, that Paul, in writing this book of Corinthians, we call it an epistle, he's responding. They wrote to him asking certain questions. What about this and what about that? So some of these he may have personally experienced, but some of them he's answering this question. That's why in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1, he said, now regarding the questions you ask in your letter, yes, it is good to live a celibate life. So they wrote these questions. We don't have that. It'd be great if we did, but you can figure out what the questions were by what the answers were. So obviously there were some questions about what happens in a church service and these sorts of things. And in this verse, the New Living Translation says, dear brothers and sisters, if I should come to you speaking in an unknown language, how would that help you? But if I bring you a revelation or some special knowledge or prophecy or teaching, that will be helpful. Again, look where the emphasis is. It's on building the body. Building the body. And again, that's not just something myself or elders or deacons or assisting pastors. No, that's something we're all supposed to be doing. Because think of it, if we all took this seriously, of building the body up, what kind of place would this be? Anybody that walked in here would be encouraged, would be built up. It would be pretty incredible, wouldn't it? And now what's stopping you from God using you to build up this place? Amen. Nothing. Come on. Your will. Now some of you may, I don't feel like it. I didn't want to. Oh, well, my goodness, don't worry about it. It doesn't apply to you. No. And it's so, and of course right now the enemy's going, oh, don't do it, don't do it. It's so hard. It's not worth the hassle. Do you know how easy it is to build somebody up, to encourage somebody? Just coming in here on Sundays or Thursday and looking at somebody and say, hey, man, it's good to see you. You have no idea. That person may have lost their job this week. They may have lost a loved one. And just coming in here and having you look at them and go, hey, it's good to see you. Thanks, man. Now, they're not going to tell you all that because we don't always share all the battles we're going through, do we? But everybody's going through some sort of battle, friend. And everybody needs this building up and this encouragement. And again, there's this spiritually selfish thing that's grabbing a hold of the church in Corinth. And they're all about, you know, I can speak with tongues and you can't. And Paul's saying, guys, you are getting off the mark. And what a timely word for this church. Because as we pour in, as we teach the Bible, you know what's so important is that you pour out. So you don't wind up like the birdbath. Amen. Verse 7 says, even things without life, whether flute or harp, when they make a sound, unless they make a distinction in the sounds, how will it be known what is piped or played? Or in the New Living Translation, I love bouncing between those two translations, but the New Living Translation in this one says, even lifeless instruments like the flute or the harps must play the notes clearly or no one will recognize the melody. So people need to understand what you're saying. And when we talk about building up the body, and this passage talks about building up the body, let's understand, we're all called. We're all supposed to be building up the body. And it's, again, it's really easy to do. And sometimes when you're not in the mood to do it, is especially when you should. How many times, don't answer this out loud, but how many times have you really not felt like coming here? You're just bummed out, you're anxious, you heard this or felt this, and yeah, I'm just not going. But then you're, yeah, no, I'm gonna go. And then you came, and that was the service where God just spoke to you. Do you think that's by accident? No. The enemy wanted you so bummed out that you wouldn't hear from God. That's a tool that he uses, not just on you. He'll use it on all of us. I was so confused as a new believer because going to the church and, you know, and with my family and young kids at the time, and man, it was like, oh, we would just have these big arguments, man, and these big thunderous clouds and And we lived 5 minutes from the church, man. You know, I mean, it broke out quickly. And I thought, man, that is so weird. And I'm, you know, and I felt, oh, I'm such a weak Christian and da, da, da. And then one day I happened to share with a leader in that church. And I said, man, I don't get this. You know, every Sunday I have like this big family fight on the way to church. And he just chuckled and he goes, yeah, that's the enemy. I went, what? He goes, no, when you get here, he wants you thinking about something else. He wants you thinking about the discussion on the way to church. He wants you to be thinking about what's wrong with your life. He wants you to think about what's wrong with your family or your marriage or your kids while you're sitting in here and you're supposed to be receiving from God himself. Now, some of you had an argument on the way to church and you're just gone. The enemy wants to put you in a place where you're not able. And then you press through. And the more you press through, the more you're encouraged. And the more likely, friend, next time you'll press through again. And then God begins to use you and one of these, as one of these people is building up the body. Because keep in mind, gang, you're either doing one or the other. The next life lesson here is we're either building up the body or tearing it down with our words and actions. We are either building up the body or tearing it down with our words and actions. Paul is here using this music analogy, and I dig that. That's cool. He's saying, you know what? Music has to make sense for people to understand it, for it to mean something. Remember the old story, there's a guy that he starts playing guitar and he plays the G chord and he gets the G chord down. So he just plays the G chord all day long. And his friends are getting really tired of the G chord, you know. So, man, what are we going to do? This guy's driving us crazy. So let's go take him to see somebody else that plays guitar, you know. So they took him out and let's watch this guy doing all this stuff, you know. Okay, let's talk to him. Hey, did you enjoy the music? Yeah, I enjoyed it. Did you enjoy that guy play guitar? Oh, yeah, I did. Well, did you notice how he was moving his hands around? The guy said, yeah. Well, what do you think about that? The guy said, well, I think he's still looking for his chord. Me, I found mine. See, music has to make sense to the listener. And so what you're saying needs to make sense to the listener. We're going to kind of open that up a little bit more with verse 8 here. Verse 8 says, for if the trumpet makes an uncertain sound, who will prepare for battle? Now, maybe you're listening to this and you're going, well, I'm not a musician. I'm not sure how this applies for me. Well, hold on just one second. Now, first of all, let's understand that we're kind of playing into the discussion that James really opens up of faith versus works. Because some people say, well, no, I'm very spiritual. Really? Well, show me. No, I mean, I'm a spiritual person. That's great. Tell me, what do you do? Oh, I don't really do anything. Well, I thought you were spiritual. Well, I am. I mean, inwardly. No, inwardly spiritual is selfish. See, because if you're spiritual, you can point, well, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, I'm serving a church, I'm giving to church, I'm doing this, I'm doing that. That's works. You're not saved by works, but you're saved for works. Once you get saved, you naturally, supernaturally start doing stuff. Friend, if you're out there and you want to ask God to forgive you, maybe for the first time, or maybe you've been freshly convicted about not building up the body, let me encourage you to pray with me. I'm going to ask that you pray out loud. It's a short, simple prayer, just telling God you're sorry and asking him to forgive you for the things you've done. Let me encourage you to ask God to forgive you, because it can be a life-changing thing. It can make all the difference. And you're why we do what we do. So please pray with me right now, out loud. Whether you're up front or still seated or listening from somewhere else, pray with me. Dear Jesus, I believe you died for me so that I could be forgiven. And I believe you were raised from the dead so that I could have a new life. And God, I've done wrong things. And I am sorry. Please forgive me of all those things. Give me the power to follow you all of my days. In Jesus' name.
If you've prayed this prayer with Pastor David, he would love to hear from you and help you get off to a good start as a follower of Christ. We'd love to bless you with a new believer's kit, absolutely free. So please call us now or write to let us know. You've just made the greatest decision you'll ever make.
Congratulations to those people who just asked God to forgive them. Awesome decision. You know, I want to encourage you, as you hear these teachings, to apply them to your life. I've dedicated myself to help and share the truths of the Bible, to help you deal with life, and to discover the abundant life that Jesus talks about and offers to each and every one of you. I also want to invite you to get a free email devotional that I send out every day. Just go to crossthebridge.com, put in your email, and I'll send you an email every day to encourage you. Hey friend, I'd love for you to come join us here Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock. And also you can watch live stream Thursdays at 7 or Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock. Also check out the website at crossthebridge.com. Do you know and love people that don't know Jesus as their Savior? You know, I want to join with you in praying for these people. And I've got hundreds of people that are committed to praying for them as well, for them to come to a saving knowledge of Jesus. Go to crossthebridge.com, put in their first names, and I'll be praying for them, and these hundreds of folks will be praying for those people to come to know Jesus. Take the time to do this. It's really important.
David McGee and Cross the Bridge want to bless you and help you. We have a series that will improve your relationship with God, improve your relationship with family and loved ones, and help you understand the Bible more. We are offering the greatest gift. This is sure to help you as well as bless you and those around you. So don't wait. Call now. Operators are standing by now, waiting on your call to get you this series that will help you know the love you are looking for. If you order in the next hour, we will include a free surprise gift, our way of saying thanks. So call now or go online and order now, and don't wait. Haven't you waited long enough to know more love?
We've put together, especially for you, a teaching package through 1 Corinthians 13. Now, we've spent hours of teaching and encouraging information in there. So let me encourage you to get this package to help you to both love other people more and to be loved more. And you'll be encouraged as you do. Thanks so much.